There you are. Welcome back to Kevin Pollak's Chat Show. I am surprisingly still Chat Show. How nice of you to join us. It's on your Christmas holiday weekend. Harry, Nathaniel, hurry, boys, with that Minute Maid. Oh, yeah. Don't forget the Stolichnaya. You don't want me to get my baseball bat now, do you, boys? Oh, the holidays.
You should use some Valencia oranges because they don't leave a bruise.
Damn it, I forgot the Valencia oranges gag. Son of a bitch. Hope your Christmas was just spectacular. I'm not going to lie to you. We've traveled back in time to do this particular outing. While you are watching live there on the day after Christmas, we are, in fact, here in the past on Tuesday the 21st, I believe it is, coming to you live from the Santa Monica, where, shockingly, it is still raining. What the hell? But I hope your Christmas was great. And by that, of course, I mean perfectly awkward and filled with disappointment. That would be a perfect Christmas, wouldn't it, though? My favorite was Aunt Bessie, in case you're wondering what the Jew was celebrating Christmas for. My family's so reformer, Catholic. And we had a Christmas tree growing up because my parents didn't quite figure out how to explain it to us because all the other neighbor kids had Christmas trees, so they said, fuck it. Get our little Jew boys a tree. And I couldn't have been happier, quite frankly, until I found out later that I was supposed to have some candles, too. So my favorite was Aunt Bessie, who, I want to say a big gal. Let's just say I'll leave it there. And for some reason, my mom insisted on getting her a new dress every year. And inevitably, Bess would say that question that we've heard before, does this dress make me look fat? And one year, I don't know whether I reached that rebellion age, whatever that rebellious age was, but I actually, because it was every year, literally, tradition, open, and then try it on, Aunt Bess. She would, and she'd come in, does this make me look fat? And every year we'd smile. And this year I said, Aunt Bess, do you want to, no, of course that dress doesn't make you look fat. Do you want to know what does, though? Vision. The fact that we can see. My father had not struck me prior to that, but I believe he did that particular moment. So Christmas is just riddled with, for the most part, disappointment, but there's a great deal of celebration in the air leading up to it, and that's the part that I kind of like, that people are a little lighter on each other, and that's a good thing. We're missing Samuel Levine, who's a back east celebrating with lots of Jews. And Jamie, you seem happy that Sam's not there. You don't have to carry him like a newborn baby.
I don't have anyone reading over my shoulder criticizing everything I type. I have all this space, which is nice.
You enjoying the real estate?
I did not get yelled at because the pita guy did not prepare his pita properly or touched it or looked at it cross-eyed. It's great. I love it.
There's your Christmas resentment right there. Gift wrapped.
There you go.
Thank you, hon.
Would like to share.
Please. Do you have a little something?
Well, because you're reminiscing about Christmas.
Yeah.
My favorite Christmas memories before I became a Grinch was I loved going to my aunt's house because she was I'm Italian. She was, big Italian cook.
Sure.
And she, but I love that when I walked into the studio today, it smells exactly like my Uncle Dave's basement.
Oh, nice.
With the cigarettes and the cheap beer. And it brings me back to my favorite Christmas.
It's a magical time.
I love it.
How dare you call Bud Light cheap beer?
It's the king of beers.
Yeah, well, at least we forget. Hello.
But I love it because I'm like, it's like my Uncle Dave's basement. Where's his Labrador, Maggie? That's all we're missing.
Is this Uncle Dave who gave me the pickled garlic?
Yes.
Yeah, I'll never forget
that. This is the same Uncle Dave that has now denounced my family ever since my aunt passed away.
Mayday.
And
Mayday.
Yes.
Charlie's in the trees.
And won't talk to any of us. So. But that's another story.
Now it feels like Christmas.
Exactly.
Yeah. Pass the yams. And go fuck yourself.
I believe that's a typical Christmas. Now that I quit therapy, I used the show as
well. Believe me, it's not a surprise to anyone at this
but
point.
But I'm saving $225 every other week.
Yes, you are, honey. And here on show 94, we couldn't be happier.
All right,
we are,
I'm done.
We are screaming to 100. But thank you. Thank you for sharing Christmas past. This is instead of the three
there was a good Christmas past, though, because
spirits.
I remember because my uncle drank Milwaukee's Best, and he'd be like, go ahead, have a couple sips. And I, you know, it was one of those, have a sip, and then you sip, and you're like, bah, I don't like this.
Now I know why you're talking about cheap beer.
Right.
Because
he
drank Milwaukee's
He drank
Best.
Beast.
I bet the people in Milwaukee would argue that. This is not our best.
He still drinks it to this day.
You know what, then?
Digging his grave.
It's a good thing. Corey, you want to share it? No, you're not mic'd.
No.
Rune?
No mic.
Good? All right. Well, I hope your Christmas was perfect, and I explained what that meant. We're going to take next Sunday off for the New Year's. Yes, we're going to give everybody a break, and then we'll be back with the great Stephen Root, who I'm just crazy about, always have been. Check the calendar, followed by, I think, Lisa Kudrow and Lauren Graham, who, speaking of which, one degree of separation, rode our guest at the Christmas holiday in a Christmas movie to happiness. Rode him into happiness. I believe that's on her resume now, if someone like that needs a resume. So Lauren Graham stopping by, and then who? We got a whole bunch. Check the calendar for yourself, goddamn. I don't have time to remember this shit. I don't have any space to remember this shit. That's my problem. There's just no space up there. That is why I need a hard drive in my ass. I first became aware of my guest today, like so many of you, in a dark little movie called One False Move. And then I found out that, he'd been in this and he'd been in that. And I thought, well, here we have a kindred spirit. He's a character actor that's done work. And it was one of those performances where you actually made the leap of faith without being asked to by the filmmaker. Your brain just immediately wrapped around, and you just thought they hired a local who was fucking crazy and dangerous. One of those type of performances that is rarely rewarded or paid for or written about. But the true fan and lover of cinema doesn't forget. And then, unlike just about any character actor that we've had on this show, we've had a great deal of them, or throughout the history of film, he took it upon himself to write, direct, and act in a movie that not just changed the rest of his career, but brought home an Academy Award. And I bring attention to this in particular because previously when actors had decided to direct something and star in it, they were very, very well known. Your Kevin Costners, your Mel Gibsons, and so on. And it was the feat of, to me, of watching someone, I've talked about it many times on the show, about being proactive. If you're not creating, you're waiting. I can't say it enough. And this was the very first time early in my professional life that I saw this happen, and it was utterly inspiring and helped change the way I thought about my potential and anyone else's. And so it is with that in mind and with tremendous gratitude on this holiday week that I welcome Billy Bob Thornton to the table. Hello, sir.
How's it going there?
Yeah, very well, thank you. I do want to start, if you don't mind, with where the fuck was this restaurant, I assume, restaurant, that you were waiting tables where you had Billy Wilder, Stanley Kramer, and God knows who else. Was this a commissary at a studio? Jesus, how did you get these guys?
Well, that story, it almost seems like a story that came out of one of those guys' movies.
Yeah.
You know, where somebody was working as a waiter and met some guy and, you know, whatever. I had a friend who worked as a waiter for a catering company.
Mm-hmm.
So this wasn't at a restaurant.
Okay.
And at that time, I was financially challenged.
Well, we all know that one.
Yes. And it was Christmas time.
Happy for the gig, I'm guessing.
Very, very happy.
Yeah.
He said, look, I'm doing this party. You know, it's some rich people's place in Bel Air, so.
Right.
it was actually on Stone Canyon Road,
I think
it was, yeah. And he said, have you ever been a waiter? I said, well, I worked at Shakey's Pizza, you know, but I made pizzas and sold a bunch of lunch and stocked the salad bar. But I think I could fake it.
Sure.
And he said, okay, well, you'll need a tuxedo. I said, well, believe it or not, I don't have one.
I can't fake that.
And this guy was about 6'3 or 4, and I'm not.
Mm-hmm.
And
he said, you're going to wear this?
He said, I've got one
oh my
for
God.
You.
Oh, my God.
So he had this this really not right tuxedo for me.
Yeah.
And I put this thing on, pinned it up, and
sure.
You know, the guy's arms were, you know, really long. And so I pinned up this tuxedo and got there at the appropriate time and everything. And it was actually at Stanley Donen's house.
Oh, my.
And for anyone who doesn't know, Stanley Donen was, he was a big musical director, mainly. He did, I think, Seven Brides for Seven Brothers. He did Singing in the Rain.
Singing in the Rain, for sure, yeah.
All those things. So here's this hugely famous old-school Hollywood director, and I had no idea where I was going, you know. It was Christmas Eve. It was a Christmas Eve party. And so I arrive at this huge place and go in, and then I start seeing all these people. And I wasn't prepared for it at all.
No.
Debbie Reynolds was there.
How long have you been in L.A. at this point?
This was in 84, or right around there, and I'd been here since, I guess, 80.
Right.
So 3 or 4 years I'd been here. And anyway, so I'm there, and he tells me that my friend, the guy who was working for the thing, he said, we're going to have you pass out hors d'oeuvres because that's kind of easy.
Sure.
You know, we're not going to make you a bartender, or which you probably should have, actually. You know, I knew more about that than I did hors d'oeuvres.
Uh-huh.
But so you're going to pass out the hors d'oeuvres, and, you know, you just go around, be nice, and, you know, don't let the pen come out of the tuxedo. And he said, the good news is not only do you get the $150 or whatever it was
sure.
supposed to be, or $200, it's a Christmas Eve party, so these people always give you a generous tip because it's Christmas Eve. So
nice.
You get kind of a double. It was like double time what they usually made plus the big tip. So I think I made $350-$400, which to me was $1.2 billion. And so anyway, I go in the kitchen.
Literally.
And what's really weird about things like this is years later when you become part of the gang.
Sure.
And you're around these people now, and they're not aware that you used to be like this guy serving them. You know, it's just really odd. And I've talked to Stanley Donen about this since.
Right.
But one way or the other, I'm in the kitchen, and Stanley Donen's in there, like, you know, kind of bossing people around. And I'm like, Jesus, I'm being directed by Stanley Donen, you know, to like serve these little tiny fish heads or whatever it was. And
that's an odd choice of an appetizer, if
yeah,
I may.
Exactly. You serve the fish heads now, you know. And so
I told everyone this was an Asian party.
Exactly. So anyway, like I said, Debbie Reynolds was there. Dudley Moore was there. He was playing piano
sure.
and singing. And it was like seeing Arthur. That was just amazing. You know?
Ridiculous.
And I remember Dan Aykroyd being there with his wife, Donna.
Mm-hmm.
And years later, I was hanging out with Dan one night in New Orleans, and I said, you're never going to believe this, but
I served you fish heads
years ago. And
he's still married to the to the reindeer.
Donna Dixon, right?
And wasn't she one of the reindeers on Santa's sleigh? On Donner, really? On Britson, on Donna Dixon.
Oh, yeah, yeah, right, exactly. That's right, yeah, she was.
Dasher, Dancer, Prancer, Nixon. Uh-huh. Comet, Cupid, Donna Dixon.
Yeah, that's it.
And she was on the show with Tom Hanks,
yeah,
right? The
Bosom Buddies. That she yeah, was, for sure. Right. I'm sorry. So,
but one way or the other, you know, things are going along. I'm passing out the fish heads, and I would go up to the bartender every now and then because somebody would ask me to ask the bartender something or whatever. Can I get a thing? And I said, well, I'm not really in charge of that, but and then just go do it because it was Debbie Reynolds or whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
So it was interesting to stand by the bar and listen to the conversations, because here I am wanting to be a part of Hollywood and everything, and listening to what these people were saying, and you would hear Dan Aykroyd say something like, yeah, I got this thing we're doing back in Chicago next week, and I'm going to, you know, that whole thing. It's like, you know, next year I'm going to be in that movie or whatever, like a moron. And so anyway, I go over to serve an hors d'oeuvre to this little guy by the hearth over here, by the fireplace. Mm. And he was just this little sort of German-speaking guy.
Right.
I didn't know who he was. I mean, I knew Billy Wilder, obviously, but, you know, growing up where I did and...
But he also wasn't a famous face.
Exactly.
He really wasn't.
No, he wasn't a famous face. And this was actually before any directors, even the directors at that time, weren't known to the public like they are now.
Right.
You know?
And maybe so, Hitchcock, that'd be bad.
Exactly.
Made himself famous.
Exactly. So I start talking to the guy about whatever it was. I'm supposed to know all this shit, but I didn't really. I mean, it's like, you know, some rolled up thing with a brown thing and a green thing hanging out of the side. I'm like, this is a grouper. I don't know. And so he says to me, in his, what I knew later was an Austrian accent, but he says, so you want to be an actor, huh?
He just knew.
And I said, yeah, how'd you know? I thought the guy had ESP. I wasn't clued in. I wasn't clued into the whole thing about all actors or waiters. You know?
Right.
But I said, yeah, how did you know that? He goes, forget about it. And I said, forget about it? And he says, yeah, forget about it. And I said, well, why should I do that? He said, well, first of all, he said, you're not ugly enough to be a character actor. You're not pretty enough to be a leading man. And you're just going to stand in a fucking line someplace and be miserable and hate yourself and want to jump off a building. There's actors on every corner out here. He said, can you write? And I said, well, actually, I just wrote a screenplay, you know. And
you'd written a couple at that point.
I'd written a couple.
Yeah.
You know, they were, the first one I wrote with Tom Epperson, we wrote it back in Arkansas because he went to the library and got a book on screenplay writing.
Perfect.
And our screenplay was like 190 pages or something like that.
As all first star.
Right. And somebody out here said, well, you know, that's not the way you do it. But one way or the other, I said, yeah, I'm actually doing that too. He goes, well, that's the thing right there. He said, do yourself a favor and be different. He said, the thing you got to do is create your own characters, create your own stories. Don't wait on these people, because you're going to end up doing what you're doing right now for a lot of years if
Holy
you do that.
Shit.
But he said, you got to do something for yourself. He said, you know, he didn't say proactive, but
no.
It was probably something like, you got to be Ratzenstichen or something like that.
Jamie, anyway, look that up. I think Ratzenstichen is in fact German for
exactly.
proactive.
But one way or the other, that's what he was, the message was.
Yeah.
Well, about that time, Stanley Donen comes over and sort of chews my ass out, you know, for bothering the guests or whatever it was, you know. And, you know, he says, what do you, you know, go over there and serve some hors d'oeuvres. Well, Billy Wilder tells Stanley to, you know,
calm down.
Fuck himself or whatever, right? You know, yeah, calm down,
I'm
Stanley.
I'm having a conversation.
I'm talking to the kid. Would you leave me alone, right? And
said that in English, did he?
Yeah, he did. And as a matter of fact, he said, I guess it pissed him off that it's like, I'm the one talking to him. You go do your thing and mingle with your guests, you know. He had me sit down.
Oh, my.
He said, put the tray down. Let me tell you something. And so we sat there, and we talked a few minutes.
Thank God he was bored at the party.
Right? And so Dudley Moore was probably playing Feelings or something at that time. He was like, yeah, I'm not going to listen to this.
He'd had it.
But so he just talked to me for a few minutes, and he said, you know, he said, I'm exaggerating about, you know, the giving up and all that. He said, what I'm trying to say to you is, you know, I've seen kids like you my whole life, you know, and, you know, trying to do this thing. And that's something that's on my mind sometimes, is I just want to tell people, you know, don't pay any attention to this stuff. And, you know, they tell you 5% of the Screen Actors Guild is working, and we'll be part of the 5%. And what are you going to do? Say, you know, fuck it, I'll go home, you know?
Yeah.
And people used to say that to me all the time. They would, or ask me that. They would say, you know, when times were so hard when you first got out there, why didn't you go home? And I said, well, if you saw what that was, you'd know why.
Yeah.
I mean, I had nothing to go back to,
yeah.
You know? And we talked about that some. And he wanted to know, you know, where I was from and why I wanted to do this. And
how did you process what was actually happening as opposed to just being witness to what was actually happening? I mean, were you open to his actual advice just then, or did it take some time to sort of put it into perspective? Because I find in those situations, once you, find out who it is you're talking to or whatever that process was, it's difficult to relax and just be in a moment like that. You know, looking back on it, it's one of the most powerful and meaningful moments of your life.
Yes.
So I'm just curious if at the time you could be present.
Not really.
Right.
I mean, all that was on my mind was, well, really not much. I mean, it was kind of a swirl of activity, you know what I mean? It was.
You felt pressure.
I felt a lot of pressure. I mean,
sure.
the guy had already told me, who hired me, who was supposed to give me like the extra $200 or whatever, had already told me to get off my ass and go do something else. So I was kind of half-assed thinking about that,
sure.
You know, and should I really be seeing? Because I still didn't know it was Billy Wilder.
Cool.
So I'm sitting there talking to this little German guy.
Somebody's father.
And I thought, yeah, it could be Debbie Reynolds' father. I don't want to be rude. I don't want to say, nah, I should really go serve some more fish heads. I got to, you know.
But he is costing me $200.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So I still didn't know at that time it was Billy Wilder. And I just think, well, it's an old guy who nobody else will talk to him, so he decides to talk to me. I figure, well, he's got to have something to do with the movie business, or he wouldn't be telling me this stuff.
Right.
But I didn't really process it in the moment. And I was actually told by one of the guys I was working with, he goes, what was he telling you? You know, and all this kind of stuff. And I go, who? Billy Wilder. I said, Billy Wilder? He goes, the little cat you're talking to over there, you know? That's Billy Wilder.
Thank God you found out before you left.
Oh, yeah, I found out almost immediately after I got up. But anyway, he was very, very nice. And but, you know, when I say nice, he was very gruff.
You're right.
He wasn't like, it wasn't like a kindly old grandfather.
No.
He was kind of he was very intense.
The nice part, you know, was fuck off, Stanley. I'm talking to the kid.
Yeah, exactly.
That was the nice part.
Exactly. And
but he was an intense son of a bitch, wasn't he?
He was very intense. And as a matter of fact, one of my favorite things I ever heard. I don't know if this is true. I hope it is. When he accepted his award at the Producers Guild or something, they gave him a Lifetime Achievement Award. And this was told to me by another old timer, who was there. So I suppose it's true. But he said he went up to accept his award, and he didn't say thank you to, you know, like the athletes always thank God first or whatever. He didn't do any of that stuff. He just walked up to the podium, took the award, and said, so the other day I go to the doctor.
Oh, my.
And and he was like 94 or whatever at the time. And I said to the doctor, doctor, I can't pee anymore.
Mm.
The doctor looks at me for a minute. He goes, how old are you? I said, I'm 94. He says, you peed enough. Supposedly, that's what his speech was.
I want that to be true.
I do, too.
Please let that be true.
Yeah. But it was a great thing. And a few years later, quite a while later, when Sling Blade came out, I got a lot of calls from a lot of really iconic people.
Sure.
You know, Elizabeth Taylor and Gregory Peck and Roddy McDowell were some of the first people who called me, and I became friends with those people, and you can't believe that you even know those people. And I get a call from Billy Wilder from his office,
mm-hmm.
and Mr. Wilder had read an article in the paper where I'd told this story, and he wanted to see me.
Oh boy.
And I went to his office down on Beverly Drive there in Beverly Hills, and we had lunch in his office. And he said, I have a book I want to sign for you. And he brought out, they made a book of Sling Blade. It was the screenplay, essentially, in book form. And
he'd made like a leather-bound copy of it?
Well, no, he just had the book there. He goes, I want to sign something for you. I have a book I want to sign to you. I thought he was going to sign me his book. He signed his autograph in my book of Sling Blade.
Holy shit.
And he wrote from a big fan, Billy Wilder and all this. And he just bragged about the movie left and right and said, this is an incredible movie and this and that. And
did he go on into detail of as to why he thought it was incredible?
He did tell me a few things. One was that I took my time with it. He said, directorially, what I loved about the movie is that you took your time. He said you would actually let a scene unfold without cutting every moment and that kind of thing. And he said you used some wide-angle lenses on close-ups and things like that that I don't see much anymore. And, so he was very complimentary about the movie. But what was funny about it was what he said about the story you read in the paper that I told. He goes, you make me feel really good that I could have a part in the career of a young man like you, that you went out and you did your thing based on my advice. He goes, I don't remember a fucking thing about it. But so he had no memory of the conversation.
Perfect.
Or anything like that. But
took pride in being a part of it as it.
Yeah. But I was glad he said that instead of trying to sort of take credit for, you know what I mean? In other words, he didn't say, I'll never forget the night I told you this and that you made this movie from the.
Oh, no.
You know, he didn't do that. He just said, he goes, I never met you in my life as far as I'm concerned, but, you know. This is great, yeah.
You know, it is incredible when you meet an icon. You have that moment of someone sharing their insights the way he did, and then to I don't want to suggest sit down on equal footing, but introduction is everything. You know, how you meet someone. So sitting there and having the casual conversation later, him being a fan and insisting on writing that in your screenplay in book form, it's as close as you get to equal footing with Mount Rushmore. And those moments, I had one recently, and I can't shut up about it on the show, because Jerry Lewis reached out of nowhere having seen my stand-up special and wanted me to know about it, how he felt. And listening to you tell the story and knowing how I've been blathering on about it, I was thinking that it's truly rare that sort of thing happens.
Yeah.
But I think you did something with Sling Blade, as I mentioned at the top, that it spoke to a lot of people on a lot of different levels, whether they were fans of film, whether they were struggling actors, struggling writers, struggling directors, all three. You had all three of those struggling categories who were sitting up going, you see?
Yeah.
I can't imagine you're aware of something like that as you're undertaking this. It's all you can do to keep your head above water.
Sure.
We put together, you know, with every guest, a little dossier. That is to say, when I decided to rip off Charlie Rose, I wanted to not have a pre-interview like so many of the talk shows do, where you rehearsed your anecdotes the day before.
Yeah.
So we put together a dossier just so I can do some research. And I couldn't find much on the difficult nature. It's one thing for you to decide, you know what, I've written a few screenplays, one false move got made and this one got made, but I'm going to do all three now. And it seems like it's unbelievably common, literally common, in the last 5 to 10 years, that sort of notion has opened up more and more to actors of varying levels of credibility. When I wrote a script that you read recently, and I remember I first gave it to my literary agent. Mm-hmm. He said, well, you have to direct this, mm-hmm. which hadn't crossed my mind. He said, you've already directed it on the page, so you have to direct this. And I said, oh, okay, but, you know, I wasn't thinking about making it as a short film. It's a feature. And he said, no, no, they'll let you direct it. I said, mm-hmm. who are they that's going to let me direct this? Mm-hmm. Couldn't wrap my brain around it. And he said, you actually have more credibility, Kevin, as a first-time director because of your credibility as an actor mm-hmm. in comparison to a director who's done 10 films, but the last four didn't do well. Mm-hmm. The studios would actually rather, not studios, but financiers would actually rather talk to you about a $5 million movie mm-hmm. For you directing based on your credibility as an actor. But you didn't have that necessarily, mm-hmm. you know? And that was a part that I was sort of focusing on at the outset. It was one thing for Kevin Costner to say, I want to direct a movie, and everyone said, mm-hmm. well, sure, Kev, what do you need? Yeah. And the same thing with Mel, and the list goes on.
Yeah.
But I am absolutely fascinated with the moment in time when you, because the little we've gotten to know each other, my sense is there's a certain amount of self-worth we all allow ourselves to have. And at some point for you to take this on is for you to believe in your core, people are absolutely going to let me do this. And mm-hmm. I can't imagine anyways, tell me if I'm wrong, you had an agent at the time, like I did, who said, you've got enough credibility that everyone's going to want you to direct your own movie. I imagine there were obstacles beyond compare.
You know, this may not be a typical situation. It's a really interesting thing, though. I mean, first of all, you bring up a really interesting thing. People will come up, they may have come up to you before and said things like this. People, I think at their core, both love and hate seeing people do well.
Yes.
And when they see the regular guy who's just struggling make it, they're like, okay, that's me. I'm one of those guys. I could have done that too. At the same time, it's like, why did that prick get to be the one who did it? Mm. So I've had people come up to me over the years, and I've done almost 60 movies at this point. And people don't know exactly what went into my life before I came to California, what it was like when I got here, or what it's like now, frankly. Mm. And I've had people come up to me and say, hey, I love that movie, Sling Blade. Boy, that's really great. So what made you want to play that part? What made me want to play that part? I invented the motherfucker. Yeah. That's what made me want to play the part. I'm a goddamn actor. I mean, you know.
Yeah.
So instead, you go, oh, that's really nice. Yeah, here's a picture I'll sign for your aunt or whatever you asked for and everything. But the fact of the matter is, you know, when somebody says to you, did you ever think about anybody else playing part? What was I going to I mean, you've seen that movie. How am I going to explain to another actor how to do that?
Without line readings.
And even then.
Yeah, and you also had workshopped it on the stage for a while.
I'd been doing that character I did a one-man show
right.
years ago. And here in town. I did it at the West Coast Ensemble, which I was a member of, that theater group. And I did it also at the Tiffany Theater up there, which I guess is now they use for the Actors Studio. But
right.
I did it as part of the one-man show. That sort of long monologue to the girl who comes with the school paper to interview right. me, it's like a 9 or 10 minute monologue. That's what I did in the one-man show. And from that, I wrote the screenplay. But when people ask you stuff like that, you know, how did you get that movie made? Or why did you do it all? And all this kind of stuff. First of all, it's like, why would you ask that? Why don't you ask, you know, whoever, Warner Brothers or Sony or whoever it is that made it? Why don't you say, Did you guys ever consider anybody besides Tom Cruise playing the part in Mission Impossible? Well, yeah, we have a list of people. Shut the fuck up.
Yeah, yeah.
That's my answer. Shut the fuck up. You know, and if you ever get a goddamn movie made,
yeah,
then I'm not going to come up to you and say, why did you star in your movie?
Yeah.
They act like you had some special privilege.
Yeah.
Or somehow your uncle was some rich guy who, you know, and the fact of the matter is after writing that script, my agent, William Morris, said, there's a guy named Larry Maestrich in New York. He has a little movie company called The Shooting Gallery.
I remember that.
And they don't have any money. They've made one movie. They made it for $60,000. They are looking for people, since they don't have any money, they're looking for people who are guys like you who write and act and do all these different things to do their own movie, but they won't pay you because they can't afford it, but they'll let you make your movie. So that's how it happened.
Holy shit.
The script was not sent to every studio in town. It was sent to one person, which was Larry Maestrich at the Shooting Gallery. So in terms of it being hard to get done, it wasn't hard to make in terms of shopping it around town for years.
Yeah.
It was hard to make because it was hard coming to California from Arkansas and having lived a life in my early days of abject poverty and knowing some of the stories that went into making that movie.
Right.
And coming out here and living in abject poverty again.
Right.
For years and years and years and years. And so that particular screenplay, it's like when people ask you, what's your process? Well, my process started when I was born. You know, it wasn't some trick I learned over at some school, you know. And so, I mean, in a rambling way, I guess what I'm saying is, yeah, it was hard to make simply because all those years went into getting to that point,
mm-hmm.
where somebody finally said, hey, here are these guys, they don't have anything and you don't have anything, you know? I'm going to put you in a room together to see what happens. Larry Maestrich said, well, what is this thing you've got? He was a fan of One False Move. And he said, I really like that One False Move. Do you have anything like that? I said, no, not exactly like that, but I got this other thing that, well, what's it about? I did the character. We were sitting at a table like this at William Morris, just me and him.
Holy shit.
I did the character for him. And when you do that character, it's quite a transformation in terms of you're just sitting there talking to a guy like this, and the next thing you know, you're Carl Childers, you know what I mean? So I did that, and he goes, fuck, dude.
So, that's a perfect reaction, by
right,
the way.
Right? And he goes, yeah. And I, you know, I have to go back a little bit because I actually didn't have the screenplay written at that point.
Mm.
I only had the short, which we had done with George Hickenlooper, that he directed, that I'd written, and all this kind of thing.
That the scene where J.T. Walsh pulls the that part where he pulls the chair up and he's talking. No, that came.
That's in the movie. In the feature. And so he said, "Look, here's the story. I think you're cool, and you know, and these guys, he and his partners, they were production assistants on movies in New York." And some of them had dads who were real estate guys or whatever they were. And so they had a little bit of money. What I didn't know when we started shooting Sling Blade was that they didn't have the money.
Oh, boy.
And they said, this is going to be our first big movie. We want to get into the big movie world. We want to make a $1 million movie, you know, which is nothing. But to them, that was going to be a big movie. And I did this character for him, and he goes, well, that's crazy, you know, let's do something. Yeah. And he said, so we want to make a $1 million movie, you know, and I said, well, that's what I was kind of looking for, something like that, you know. Later on, way after we'd made the movie, after it had made a lot of money and we'd gotten the Academy Award nominations and all this stuff, I found out that when we started the movie, they had about $30,000. If I'd known that,
oh boy,
I would have freaked out and been nervous every day, but I didn't know that, and they never told me. they were actually getting the money as we went along, just borrowing it from different people and
they were producing parents. The film, so they were writing the checks along the way.
Yeah.
You didn't have to oversee that thing.
I didn't.
Thank goodness.
I mean, I wouldn't have known what they were doing anyway. I don't know anything about money. I never did. But I had no idea that that was the case. And
well, like you said, it was a damn good thing you didn't.
It was a real good thing I didn't.
Yeah.
And anyway, so that's the way it got made. There was one woman that we did talk to about the movie. Once I'd written the screenplay, maybe it was after we'd made the movie. I can't remember. There was a woman with a big distribution thing. It was one of those like Fine Line or one of those things like that. Her name was Ruth Vitale. I'll never forget her name.
Oh, yeah.
And a friend of mine knew her or something. It was sent to her. And her words were, "I don't get it."
Holy shit.
And after she saw the movie, I remember her coming up to me and saying, "Hi, I'm Ruth Vitale." And I said, "Yeah, I remember your name." And she said, "I don't know. I still don't get it."
What a lovely reason to come up to someone.
Yeah. Yeah, she was real mean. I remember that.
Yeah.
Yeah. But that's the only person who ever said a negative word about that movie. And One False Move, as critically acclaimed as it was, had one bad review that I remember. I think it was the San Francisco Chronicle. I'm not positive of that. Excuse me. But the movie's called One False Move, and the sort of headline,
no.
You know, they love to be clever, right? Was One False Movie. And so we thought that was pretty funny that the guy had, you know, spent his night thinking that up and shit, you know. And
How many did he cross a line through and go, "That's not quite right,"
before he got to
One False Movie?
Yeah. You know, you wonder about that because especially in these days and times, the idea is to be clever and mean.
Yes.
That's the way you get your, that's the way you build a name as a critic or whatever. Which is a real shame because the guys who spent their lives dedicated to motion pictures and a love of motion pictures, who go way back, Roger Ebert or Leonard Maltin or Jeffrey Lyons or any of those guys.
That's why I had Leonard at this table 3 weeks ago.
Leonard's a great example, and so is Roger, and so was Gene Siskel. And these are not guys I'm naming because they just love me and say everything I do is gold. I mean, you know, it's not like Roger, has given me a good review on every movie I've ever done, but he's a decent human and he loves movies. And the things that he said about things I've been in that he didn't like,
right.
I've agreed with him.
Yeah.
And the movies he's loved of mine, I've agreed with him on those too.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I think the guy knows what he's talking about. And maybe sometimes he doesn't.
Well, it's no longer.
But he's a real thing.
But he's a real guy who's done his homework. And like you said, it's not a case of if it bleeds, it leads. And it is the unfortunate part. It drives me crazy, and I've gone on a little too much about it on this particular show, so I won't launch again now. But the truth of the matter is you don't make a name for yourself for liking anything.
No.
Unless it's something no one else has ever heard of, and then you can feel special about yourself.
You know, I've put up with this in music a lot because it's always an actor trying to make records. Trying to make records. No, actually, I did make it, and it's out there. And by the way, the record, you weren't walking through Best Buy and the fucking record jumped in your shopping cart. You know what I mean? We don't build records with legs. So don't listen to it. If you think I'm another actor trying to make a record, don't fucking listen to it. Because if you already have that preconception,
right,
then I would never listen to shit I did. You know what I mean? It's just don't do it.
Yeah.
So I put up with that kind of thing quite a bit, where I'm a guy who grew up in the music business, worked as a roadie, starved to death doing that stuff, and actually know a little about music history, so it kind of sucks to listen to that stuff. But
how dare you diversify?
Right? So the thing is, and I'll use the music business as an example, if the people they call critics now, which are guys who have their own blog or whatever the hell it is, or just some guy with a garter on his fucking neck sitting there like grueling snot, you know, and his mother catches him jerking off to pictures of his favorite actress, and then he writes a review of me, who he hates, because I was married to Angelina, and he thinks I never deserved that, so he's going to write some bad shit about me. And you'll get some today. I swear to God, they'll write in today and say, yeah, that's right. You know, that's what they'll think of. And another thing. But anyway, so
that's not all.
Yeah. So these guys, you know, if I put out a record and didn't say that it was me and said I'm a blind guy,
bingo,
from New Orleans,
bingo,
who lived on the streets and I have one leg and I barely even, you know, can feed myself anymore and I shit myself every other minute and call myself something like Bongo or something.
Blind Bongo,
because the guy doesn't really know what his real name is because his parents dumped him off in the fucking swamp and he was half eaten by an alligator and shit like
We've
that.
We've got a package, Blind, you know, Bongo. Jesus, this is too good.
Right?
You can't give this away.
Yeah. Well, the next
one stripped online.
He's on next week.
I mean, the next thing you know, you can write songs.
You're a hero.
So
you're,
I mean,
absolutely right.
This overprivileged fuck like me,
who has
the money to make a record, which, by the way, I don't.
Right.
You know what I mean? And you got a record deal because you're a movie star. No, they wouldn't give me a record deal because I was a movie star.
It doesn't work that
way. I begged
way.
For a fucking record deal and got one with Vanguard, God bless them.
Right.
You know, because that's like an old school label and they kind of don't give a shit like that. Yeah, but.
Or maybe they're aware of what you're trying to accomplish as a musician.
That type of thing. Yeah. So, anyway, not to go off on a tangent.
Oh,
but
I'm glad you did.
I'm glad you did.
You touched on a lot of stuff. Quite frankly, you just went through six of my pages.
That's how I get on Tuesdays. I mean Sundays.
You know, I have only one question about you and Angelina, and I guarantee you, you've never been asked this. I was visiting my then-wife's family in Nashville, Tennessee, and it was a holiday of some kind. I don't remember which. Maybe I think it was probably
Easter. You just blocked that whole
Easter.
Part of your life out,
yes.
Right?
Yes, the majority of it. Yes, honey, I have. So we were staying at the Vanderbilt Hotel. Mm-hmm. In Nashville.
Oh, wait. I don't get to stay at these fancy hotels.
Shut up. And there was an outdoor baseball game with a bunch of families and stuff. And afterwards, I felt kind of weak and feverish. And sure enough, that night, I felt fluish. And then to the point where I couldn't really get out of bed the next morning. And so we called the hotel doctor. I wish there was a quicker version of the story. Anyways, he comes in and he tells me, asks me, have you ever had chickenpox? And I said, well, I don't have any memory of it. And he said, then you probably didn't, because you certainly would remember it. I called my mom, and God bless her, she couldn't remember either. So I laid up in that hotel room for a couple days with a very mild case, I'm happy to say, of chickenpox, during which you break out of those little chickenpox things. Well, I was a smoker at the time, and so I would have to sneak out of the hotel room, all hat and glasses and coat up, to go down to the garage to have a cigarette. Mm. And there was a couple of other relatives staying in the hotel, and I was just deathly afraid that I would run into one of them in the hallway, right? So I was really trench coated up, you know, top cat really was what was happening here. I was trying not to be seen. And
this is because you hid smoking from your wife.
And I hid smoking from
my... Which blows my mind still to this day. How can you hide the fact that you smoke?
Yeah.
But that's another story.
You know what, honey? We'll save that one for next week. So I'm hiding up, right? Going down the hallway, approaching the elevator. And I've only got another 12 feet before I'm in the clear in that elevator. And who do I see walking towards me in the opposite direction but you and Angelina? Mm-hmm. Before the world knew. Mm-hmm. So I certainly didn't have a heads up that you were in the hotel. I certainly didn't have a heads up that you were a couple, and I certainly didn't have a heads up that I wasn't getting on that elevator scot-free. Right. It was one of the single most surreal moments of my particular life, and all I kept thinking was not now, anytime but now. I looked like the Elephant Man if he had chicken pox. I can't imagine it, you recall this at all.
Well, unfortunately, it's not like the Billy Wilder thing where he didn't ever. I was like, I turned to Angie, I said, look at Kevin Pollak. He looks like the Elephant Man. What the fuck is going on with this guy? You know? I mean, it looks like gigantic chicken pox or something.
The man's covered in bizarre giant acne.
No, I don't remember that, but I remember us being there.
Yeah.
I know exactly what that time was.
Yeah.
We were staying at Lowe's Vanderbilt,
mm-hmm.
and we were there for a few days. I was recording some demos over at Ocean Way Studio, and she'd come down there with me, and her brother was down there too, Jamie. He was there at the time.
Mm-hmm.
And and we were just tooling around Nashville, and I was cutting some demos there. After that, it wasn't too long, I think, before she did that movie, Original Sin, her mm-hmm. and Antonio Banderas. And then not too long, well, I think maybe right after the making of that, I think it's when we went to Vegas and got hitched up.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's probably maybe a year or two before we got married.
Oh yeah, it was definitely before anybody knew. In fact, I was, like I said, just horrified to be seen. But then I was horrified to tell anyone because then they'd say, "Well, what were you doing sneaking out of the hotel room when you were sick?" And then that would lead to me getting busted for smoking.
That's
so
funny.
I ultimately carry the secret until this very moment.
That's wild. That is really funny.
It was pretty fucking ridiculous. I mentioned Rigetti before, and it did remind me of. The Freak was pitching against the Dodgers here in June, and so I was going to bring a couple of friends to go. And I don't know if you know Rob Moore, second in command over at the Paramount Studios. He's part of Hank Azaria's poker game. And so every now and then when the Giants come to town, he'll call me up with some great seats, right? So this particular time, I bring a friend of mine, Matt Craven, great character actor, you
sure.
probably know.
Yeah.
So his son and he... were going to come with me to the baseball game. He'd been telling his son since his son was born, who was about to go off to college. This last June was the last summer before college. He'd been telling him since the kid was born, here's a ticket. Dave Rigetti pitched a no-hitter in 1983 on Fourth of July for the Yankees. It was my first baseball game in America because Matt Craven is from Canada. And this had been, he'd carried the ticket with him forever. So, sure enough, when I invite him to the game, he brings the ticket. Because I had told him that I went to school with Rigetti, and if there's any way to get Rigetti to sign the damn ticket, could you imagine? So all throughout the game, I'm up out of my seat. I'm trying to get near the dugout. And, you know, Rigetti, like a lot of coaches, stays way back in. You can't get him out on the rails. God bless Dunk for standing out there with Tony, you know. But Rigetti's hidden back in there, so I can't get at him the whole game. Anyways, I finally, after the game's over, and we're gathered near the dugout, and he comes out. So he's signing the ticket for Matt Craven. And Matt, this magic golden ticket that's been in the Craven family now and is going to be passed down to the son. The son's been hearing the story his whole life, and now he's watching this pitcher who's a pitching coach now and is signing this thing for his dad. It's just beautiful and wonderful in terms of a father-son baseball story. And Rigetti breaks it with, yeah, I remember that 4th of July game at Yankee Stadium. Nixon was there that game. The only reason I know that is because after the game I was in the locker room and coming out of the shower, standing in my locker room from behind me, I hear, Rigetti. He said I shrunk up faster than I had in the cold shower. So I tell Jamie this
fantastic
story, and then for the next 2 weeks, she's come sneaking up behind me saying,
Rigetti.
That's fantastic.
Yeah.
I'm very good at doing impressions of people doing impressions.
Yes, you are the king of the impressions impression. Growing up in Arkansas, but you became a fan of the St. Louis Cardinals pretty early on.
Yeah, everybody in Arkansas is a fan of the Cardinals because we didn't have a pro team.
Right.
And, you know, we in any sport, you know. So everybody was a Dallas Cowboys fan and a St. Louis Cardinal fan in baseball. I was a St. Louis Cardinal fan and a Dallas Cowboy fan by birth.
Mm-hmm.
But I was also a Baltimore Colts fan.
Really?
I was a big fan of Johnny Unitas.
Oh, yeah.
And Tom Matty and Raymond Berry, you know, all those guys. Art Donovan, one of the best talk show
Holy crap.
Guests of all time.
Yeah.
And And then that's why these days I'm a big Indianapolis Colts fan, because I've loved them since then. I'm not from Baltimore, so I can't hate them like everybody else for moving out of town.
Yeah, you didn't talk to Levinson about that. Yeah,
exactly.
Holy shit, will he go off on that?
Oh, he goes off on it bad.
But God bless him. He was born and raised with one.
Absolutely, and I totally get it.
Yeah.
But yeah, Cardinals were our thing, and I grew up being a big fan of Bob Gibson and all those guys. And the funny thing about it is, and I actually talked to Gibson about this one time when we were down at Busch for maybe the All-Star game or World Series game or something. But there was a Sports Illustrated in, I guess, 67 or 68, and it had, the cover was a fold-out.
Wow.
And the fold-out of the cover was the St. Louis Cardinals starting lineup with Gibson as pitcher with their salaries underneath each one of them in the bench, talking about the salaries of baseball players and stuff like that.
In 67, 68?
Yeah, I think it might have been 68. Gibson was the highest paid at like $150,000 or $200,000, something like
crazy
that.
Crazy money.
Yeah,
back
right?
Then. Crazy.
Back then. And then guys like Julian Javier and Dal Maxville, guys like that, the guys who were hitting like 220,
right.
You know? Their salaries were like something, I'm pretty sure I'm not making this up, I think it was like $8,500 a year.
Yeah.
$8,500 a year. Astounding to think about something like that.
Truly.
Now.
It was after the World Series, when we were in St. Louis, when they beat the unbeatable Tigers. In fact,
that's right.
When he said that one season in the offseason, he played for the Harlem Globetrotters.
That's right.
And he told that story of the GM coming to him saying, well, don't play the Harlem Globetrotters in the winter. I can't have that. What if you get injured? And he said, well, I need the $400, which is what he was making for the season.
Yeah.
And he said, no, I need the money. And he said, well, how much are they paying you? And he said, it's $400. And he said, we'll pay you $400 more. Stop playing for the Harlem Globetrotters.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, holy crap.
So that was at that game we were at.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's the Cardinals. I don't know. I mean, you and I are both really close friends with some of those guys, particularly Tony La Russa. And, you know, there's something about that team that, I mean, obviously the Yankees have it. You know, that tradition and all that kind of thing. The Cubs, a few teams like that. There's something about the Cardinals. It's such an intense fan base.
You think it's the history?
You know?
I mean, a lot of people don't know, and I didn't find out until I read Buzz's book, really, that you obviously knew this, I'm sure, that the oldest rivalry in baseball was between the Cubs and the Cardinals.
Cubs and the Cardinals, yeah. It's so intense. And, you know, I love Chicago. Chicago is one of my favorite towns on planet Earth.
Mm.
I'd rather go to Chicago than anything in the world. But when it comes to baseball, and I've got Cub friends, Cub fan friends, you know, John Cusack being one. When it comes down to the baseball season, it's just venomous.
Don't talk to me.
I mean, it's so bad.
Yeah.
Even when the Cubs suck, it doesn't matter.
They can't suck enough.
They can't suck enough for me.
That's right. It's in your DNA.
It is in my DNA.
And I wonder what the parallel would be for women. I know it exists for them, where there's something in their DNA that creates a rivalry that they can't explain.
Shoes.
There we have it. No more calls. Pencils down. Papers forward. I do understand it. And it's why, in fact, living here since 1983, that year comes back, for me, I've only been in Dodger Stadium three times. Because when you grow up in San Francisco, there's no greater enemy on the planet.
Absolutely.
And even when my Giants come to town, I won't go there. Because I will not spend a dollar and give it to that.
Oh, I hear you.
The graveyard known as Chavez Ravine.
Exactly. I mean, I can go to Dodger Stadium because we're not usually that worried about the Dodgers, you know.
One of the three times I went was because Tony came to town and said, you got to come out.
Exactly.
I said, yes, I do, sir.
You know, Mark McGwire, who's a really nice guy.
Love him to death.
Love Mark. he asked me to quit coming to the games one year because every time I came, he pulled a muscle in his back. He got thrown out. Mark McGwire never got thrown out of games.
No.
He was the nicest guy.
Yes.
I go to the I go up to a game in at Busch to throw out the first pitch in 98. This is the year he hit the 70 home runs.
Holy shit.
He had asked me himself, he said, hey, why don't you come up to the game and we'll hang out after the game and all that, and Tony and I were going to say hi to each other. This is back when I first knew Tony. And I was making this movie, Daddy and Them, down in Arkansas. And I think I'd told Mark that or something at Dodger Stadium or something when they were playing here. And he said, yeah, come on up. And the Cardinals organization had already called me and said, hey, would you like to throw out the first pitch while you're in Arkansas making this movie? One of the games come up, so we picked this one. They were playing the Braves. Tom Glavin was pitching. I remember that much. And two things happened that day. First of all, Jack Buck, God rest his soul, Jack Buck and Mike Shannon asked me if I wanted to come into the booth.
Oh, boy.
And call an inning.
Oh.
Call an inning.
That's way beyond first pitch.
Right.
Way beyond
yeah.
first pitch.
And so I've thrown out, I threw out the first pitch. It was such an amazing day because, first of all, I was back in the clubhouse with Tony and McGwire, and I was going to be throwing out the first pitch, and Tony said, hey, you know, your hero's here today. Gibson's here.
Holy shit.
So they brought Gibson in, and that was the first time I'd ever met Gibson. And I grew up as a pitcher, as you know, and I was a junk pitcher, and I learned all my pitches out of a pitching instructional book by Bob Gibson. Learned my slider, my changeup, everything out of this book. And and then my dad refined the
sure.
pitches between whacks.
uh-huh.
And one way or the other, we start making pictures, the four of us back in the clubhouse. And it was cool that I'm having my picture made with Gibson.
Absolutely.
Kind of thing.
Your hero.
And Tony says to Gibson, hey, Bob, I mean, you're the guy's hero. You ought to catch the ball he's throwing out the first pitch today. Well, I nearly shit myself. Now, not only am I throwing out the first pitch at Busch, you know, before, you know, all these fans, a sold-out crowd.
God.
Now I'm throwing it to Gibson, my hero. Well, he knows through me, like before this happened, I'm over the corner with him bragging on myself about, well, yeah, you know, Bob, I learned my slider from you, and, you know, I can still throw it and blah, blah, blah.
I was trying out for the Royals at
yeah,
one
exactly.
point.
And yeah, and I told him the whole story, how I'd had a tryout with the Kansas City Royals.
Right.
And so now I can't go out there like a politician and roll the fucking thing on the grass halfway up there. I got to throw him a ball. You
got to bring the heat.
Exactly. So I got out there, and there's Gibson squatted behind home plate.
Oh,
I mean, he got down in the position. He wasn't just standing there and stuff. He was down there kind of winking at me saying, you better throw a fucking ball, you know.
Or strike.
Exactly. And so I decided, I'll never get this opportunity again. The slider that was my best pitch when I played, I've got to throw it. I can tell people, even if I throw the fucking thing, you know, in the dugout, I can still say, I tried to throw my slider. I went for it. I threw him a slider about probably 5 or 6 inches off the plate. Perfect.
Holy shit.
I mean, it was like one of the better ones I ever threw. I mean, it had the velocity on it. It had the right break. I mean, it was Gibson caught the ball right where the motherfucker struck out. I mean, it was good.
He was proud.
He was proud. Gibson came out with the ball.
Uh-huh.
Tosses it in my glove. He goes, man, that's a damn good slider. Did you get that? I said, well, I was telling you, in that book you did, that's how I learned the thing, you know. And he goes, damn, it was good, man.
Yeah.
It was really good. And then, because before that, he'd been, you know, as Gibson can be, a little standoffish, you know,
yeah.
Which I think people exaggerate that a lot. Because he's shy.
Yeah.
But he just totally came out of that shell with me and started telling me stories about he and Hank Aaron. Told me a great story about throwing a knuckleball to Hank Aaron one time, and Aaron, like, running after he grounded out to Gibson or something on the knuckleball, and as Aaron's running back from first base to the dugout, he passes by him and he goes, the hell was that? He goes, it's my knuckleball, man. He goes, you don't have a knuckleball. He goes, I know. It's just funny. You know,
I do now. Shit.
Exactly. But funny stuff like that. But anyway, so I've thrown out the first pitch to Bob Gibson. I'm on cloud nine. I've thrown a perfect slider.
Yeah, you have.
Now I'm going up. Now I get to go call an inning with Jack Buck and Mike Shannon. I get in there, and I can't say anything.
And you froze up a little?
I froze up. Like they think you're an actor. You can do any of this kind of media type stuff.
Nope.
That's the hardest thing a human could ever do. I mean, I literally said stuff like, and now the batter's coming up and to hit stuff and things. You know, I mean, it was just horrible.
Had heard maybe 5,000 games called.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I mean, I worship guys like Jack Buck and Vin Scully, and, you know, can talk with guys like you about, yeah, you know, the interesting thing about Vin Scully, you know, I know every fucking thing, right? I get up there.
Nothing.
Nothing. Had nothing. Well, in the first inning, and actually this wasn't the next thing that happened, the calling the inning. They got me up there like the fifth or sixth inning, I think, to do that. Before that had happened, McGuire is sort of my host up there.
That's right.
He's the guy who said, hey, we'll hang out after the game. This is going to be great. And you're throwing out the first ball. That's great. McGuire's first trip to the plate, and I guess he's hitting third, I think. I don't know if he's hitting third or cleanup, but one way or the other, his first trip to the plate, it was in the first inning, I know that. He goes to the plate, Glavine throws a ball that could have broken his ankle. That's how low the ball was and inside. Ump calls a strike to strike him out. McGuire went ballistic and got thrown out of the game in the first inning. I've never seen Mark McGuire thrown out of a game.
I don't know that it's happened to him other than that.
And they threw him out of the game. And here I am. I'm supposed to see the guy after the game. This is the first inning. He's already out of the game.
He's at the bar.
I never even called him. I had his cell phone number. I never even called him. I was like, I'm not going to go hang out with him tonight. Got thrown out of the game.
No.
And I went to see him at Dodger Stadium. Goes to the bat, pulls a muscle in his back, the muscle he always had trouble with. Pulls a muscle right after he had signed a dirty batting glove to me from the dugout, and he was waving at me and shit, and he throws the glove up to me and everything, goes to the bat, pulls a muscle, comes back, he's in the dugout, and he's going, just shaking his head at me like, you motherfucker. You know? And like three or four times I came to games where he, you know, cut himself up or pulled a muscle or he gets thrown out of the game and against the Braves.
Well, you'd be hard-pressed, and I'm a gambler my whole life, but you'd be hard-pressed to find someone more superstitious than a baseball man.
Mm.
They're ridiculous.
Yeah, they are.
I mean, it's beautiful, the illness that they carry with them every day.
It's fantastic.
When they suit up. It really is beautiful. We have something here. I want to bring in our audience here. At least we forget they're there, although it's awful fun to do when you're chatting. There's something on the show where it is a rapid-fire question, a this or that, a Coke or Pepsi, no correct answer kind of thing. Mm-hmm. And the fans will put them in particular to the guest so that it's fitting, appropriate, mm-hmm. if you were. This one comes from Holden Pike. This is a Tweet 5, and then Dave Tweet Koechner five. Was on the show, and Tweet he liked the Tweet 5. He can't Tweet see it over there. It's back behind
Koechner.
And Dave Koechner gave us a little song. All right, so here we go. There's five of them. It's this or that, no correct answer, just stream of conscious kind of thing. Westerns or film noir?
Westerns.
Sam Peckinpah or Sam Fuller?
Sam Peckinpah.
Tom Waits or Warren Zevon?
Fuck.
I know, right? Now we know where your heart is. We got to the music one and they got you.
Fuck.
Uh-huh. No correct answer.
No correct answer.
Uh-uh. In fact, there's no answer, period. Jim Jarmusch or the Coen Brothers?
Coen Brothers.
Steven Seagal or an asteroid the size of Texas?
Asteroid the size of Texas.
That would be the correct answer. Well, tell me a little bit about your run-ins with maybe both those fellows. I know the connection with Warren Zevon's a special one.
Yeah.
Start out as inspiration, I imagine.
Yeah. Warren and I met through a different circumstance other than the movies or music or anything like that. I lived in an apartment building over on Kings Road, West Hollywood.
Mm-hmm.
And this is in the 80s. Warren was my neighbor.
Is that right?
And we met at the, you know, in these apartment buildings, they have the bank of mailboxes. You go, when you get in from your shitty job, you go look in your mailbox and
there's
no residual, no nothing, you know, some flyer and some horseshit, you know. And a letter from your mom, but there's no money in it.
No.
You know. So I was at the mailbox.
Right.
And I opened my mailbox, and I know, you know, you're aware somebody's next to you, but I'm not looking over there. Somebody next to me. I open the mailbox, and I take my mail out. I put the mail back in. I shut the mailbox. I open it again. I take the mail out. I do that however many times I was going through at that time. It could have been seven. It could have been three. And this guy goes, "You got it too, huh?" I look up, and there's Warren Zevon. Well, I wasn't a famous guy yet, so he didn't know who the fuck I was. And it was right when we were making One False Move.
Wow.
I was just about to go make that movie. 89, I think it was. And, but I knew that was Warren Zevon.
Yeah, you
I
did.
I was a big fan of his. And I said, yeah, I do have it. So we met over obsessive compulsive disorder.
Right.
And after that,
that's got to be a quick bond, by the way.
It's a very quick bond, and the thing about it is everybody says they have it. You know, it's like if I tell somebody, well, yeah, I've suffered from OCD, I've actually, you know, gone through a lot over it, and I have this severe learning disability and dyslexia and all these different things, and people always go, oh yeah, I've got that.
Yeah.
I always put my left shoe, on first, and I said, you have no idea. That's like junior league shit, you know, compared to the stuff I've got.
Yeah.
And, but Warren and I started having competitions over who had worse OCD.
That I like a lot.
Warren finally won when one day he said to me, "Do you have it with guns?"
Holy
shit.
And I
said, no, you win.
You win. Son of a bitch.
Yeah. You got me.
Do you have it with guns?
Every now and then Warren would have to shoot the floor or something. Yeah.
Uh-huh.
You know, because it gets in your craw and you got to get rid of it.
Yeah.
Because it borders on Tourette's in some ways, you know, with some people.
Right.
And, I mean, I'll be in a supermarket line every now and then and see a guy with, you know, like a fuzzball from his sweater on his ear or something, and I got to get it. and the explanation you have to give is always interesting. You know, it's like, you know, you're standing there and you'll just kind of go, oh, sorry, I was reaching for that magazine or whatever, and really you're just, you know, flicking the dust ball off of me.
Uh-huh.
But people who have Tourette's, obviously, they go through worse ones where they have to actually go up and, like, thumb the guy's nose or whatever, you know. And Tourette's is bad. That's a bad affliction. I mean, Tourette's is a really serious thing, but I don't give a shit what anybody says. I can't help but laugh. I mean, if you hear a guy barking in a fucking supermarket, you're going to laugh. And there's nothing you can do about it.
No, it's involuntary human reaction.
Exactly.
Is what
I mean,
got
hey,
there.
By the way, they're doing it.
it's important for the OCDs to laugh at the Tourette's.
It certainly is.
Let's not forget.
But anyway, that's the way I met Warren.
And I imagine you guys were lifelong friends.
Yeah, I mean, Warren was at the house a lot before he died. I wouldn't be able to handle death the way Warren did. He was very, very at peace with it.
Mm.
And a lot of things came back to him, I think, that, because, you know, Warren could be a curmudgeon.
Letterman talked about that and the way that he handled his death, too.
Yeah.
I remember one night on the show, it was one of the things that Dave has done well over the years. You know, he was the first broadcaster back after 9/11 who really took a moment and said, and it was one of the great nights of broadcasting journalism for me, or in terms of just being a broadcaster.
Yeah,
that's what
absolutely.
I mean to say. No, and he did one of those about Warren too after his passing.
Yeah,
and he spoke to those very things too. And for someone who didn't have an awareness of that aspect of Warren's life, it became crystal clear.
Yeah,
in that. That observation.
You know, Warren gave me a ring that he wore all the time.
Mm.
And it was one of those moments where it was kind of like, you know, I'm dying. I want you to have this.
Holy shit.
It's my ring. And Warren was as sick as anybody I ever knew. I mean, his sense of humor, you know. And Rivaled only by, believe it or not, John Ritter, who was known as the boy next door, but Ritter had a really sick sense of humor.
Oh, good. Let's go there next.
But Warren hands me the ring, and we were in a very serious moment for a change. And I took the ring, and I said to Warren, "You don't expect me to wear this fucking thing, do you?" Which busted him up, you know. But that's the way he was, and yeah. He would expect me to say something like that. So it's like, "Yeah, right. I'm going to put this in a steel fucking box and bury it in another county. I don't have this shit near me. Next thing I know, I got mesothelioma too. Fuck you, you know." But he was a very, God, what an artist and what a great human and everything about him. Yeah, I loved him.
Yeah, to be a true original, and then to follow your own path as you have, and then to come across and get that close to someone who stands alone in his field for his whole
Absolutely.
Career.
Yeah,
no one ever did what he was doing or even tried. Yeah. I am going to have to ask just one nugget on Ritter, because you guys became very close. And I had heard this once before, that he had a little bit of a streak in him that his public would never know.
No.
I hadn't seen Sling Blade in so long that I actually watched three scenes last night, one of which is when he tells your character, at the diner, whatever, that he's gay and is asking if he knows what that means. And holy shit, that whole exchange, was just one of those reminders, not only of how there was no more Billy there and how ridiculous that was, and that was the reason I was tuning in, to be reminded of this mind-altering experience as a fan, but also to see what John had done and how no one had really given him a chance to go anywhere near that kind of performance in his whole career.
Yeah, that's right.
And here you were in a place where you weren't going to get flack from anyone, as you explained how your film came to be financed. I'm sure they were thrilled just to have the name John Ritter attached. Didn't matter.
Yeah.
So I imagine there must have been some personal joy and satisfaction in watching a fellow actor of that talent be able to do something like that in your film.
Well, it's like they say, you know, going back to the music thing earlier, well, if you're an actor, you can't make a record, or if you're a comic, you can't do this. But, you know, it's not like somebody goes up to a guy that works at the car wash and at night he's a security guard and says, "Hey, wait a minute.
Yeah, you can't clean cars and..."
Exactly. "What do you know about security guards?"
Yeah.
You know, you wash cars.
Yeah.
John Ritter was one of those guys who never got the chance because of the pigeonholing that can happen in our world. And
because he was so spectacular.
He was spectacular.
As we discovered him.
Yeah. As that guy who on Three's Company or all that. And also John had that look about him. John Ritter, you can trust him with your kids. You know, he can take them to school and you can, you know, he's a Mr. Guy Next Door.
Also felt like he could help me get a loan.
Absolutely. Take Ritter with you, you'll be okay.
Yeah.
It's like when Chris Rock said, when you go out at night, you know, for black guys to keep from being beat up by the cops. I don't know if you ever saw this or not, but Chris Rock has a hilarious deal about how to not get beat up by the cops. He goes, first of all, take a white guy. You know what I mean? It's like he got the white guy in the car. Well, Ritter was that guy. It's like, you know.
Yeah.
Just take Ritter with you, you're going to be okay. And instead, you know, it's like Ritter's the guy on your shoulder over here going, you know what we could do? You know? But, you know, all those parts in that movie, because when I was writing the script, I was working on this TV series, Hearts of Fire, with John.
Yeah.
And Marky Post.
Marky Post.
A bunch of people, Ed Asner. Marky Post, best legs in the business, you know?
Uh-huh.
And, so when I was writing the script, John was the first guy I asked to be in the movie. And I wrote the part for him. So that was one luxury in writing that script, is I knew who I was writing it for. I'd already written the part for J.T. Walsh when we did the short. But other than J.T., everybody else was, you know, it was left to be determined. So I asked John, I said, look, would you do this? And he goes, yeah, sure. He was going to do it as a favor. I was making my little movie and all that kind of thing. So he didn't really realize yet what that was going to be. He didn't know he was going to be gay. He didn't know he was going to have that haircut. A lot of stuff. And so I got to write that specifically for him. And when he showed up in Benton, Arkansas at the Ramada Inn to his room, I told the girl, I said, imagine he's a gay guy from St. Louis who's been transferred down to his department store in this little town in Arkansas, and but he still subscribes, all the magazines he subscribed to there, like GQ and whatever, he still gets them here. So he's gone to the local barbershop or beauty shop in this town and has shown them a picture in GQ and said, I want to look like that. And it's the job that they would have done on him in this town. I said, that's the haircut I want.
I never heard that explanation, and now I get it.
And that's what happened. And John had no idea. He's sitting there talking to me while Kate, the hair gal, was cutting his hair.
Oh, my God.
And when he's through, well, she's done cutting his hair, and he turns around, and she's dyed it, which was supposed to be blonde, by the way. It turned that kind of reddish.
Orange, yeah.
Puke orange color. He turns around and looks in the mirror and he goes, I'm going to fucking kill you. He goes, I have to do a PSA for AIDS or whatever it was, you know, when I get done with this movie. He goes, I can't fucking look like this. He goes, what are you doing to me? I said, John, that's the character, man. And here's the explanation. But I really didn't know it was going to turn out that way either, quite, you know. So, but that's how all that happened.
Holy crap.
But anyway, so yeah, it was so good to be able to put John in a role because I knew he could do it and other people knew he could do it. He never got the opportunity and he was so amazing in that movie. And
Holy crap.
It's just a shame to me to this day that he and Dwight didn't both get. They obviously couldn't both get nominated for supporting actor. They probably did cancel each other out, but both those guys and Lucas Black, all of them, deserve a lot of credit. Natalie Cannaday, who played the mother, but the funny one with John, the sick sense of humor thing that you want to know about.
Please
check this one out.
One nugget.
I won't mention any names here, but I had been with a girl for several years. Who's an attractive woman in her own right, and a smart woman, and talented, and everything else. I'd been living with her for several years, and then I wasn't any longer, and I was with another very attractive woman who was very talented. And it became very public instantly when it was found that we were together. And so the very day that it came out that we were together and I was no longer with the other girl, I was being followed by press and it was a big thing. You know how people for some reason like that shit. I don't know what the big deal is, but you're actually chased down. I mean, you know, like the South Korea, North Korea, right? You know, it's pretty dicey right now, but people still want to know what Lindsay Lohan's deal is. That's more important to us than that. Never understood this shit, but one way or the other, I've been through it, I know what it's like. I'm being hounded, people in the bushes, people following you and everything else. I was supposed to go to Ritter's house that day, just to go hang out, and we were gonna talk something over that we were planning. So I go over to Coldwater Canyon there, I go over to his house, and he was there alone that day. Amy, his wife, wasn't there at the moment. And so I pull up in the driveway, get out, knock on the door. Ritter answers the door with no hello or anything. He goes, nice trade. Anyway, so that's how sick Ritter was.
No, man. Well, thank you for sharing that. That's that would be filed under little known fact. That's good. That is good. Oh, we lost Captain Beefheart recently. This is a from Tyler Shaw coming at you with another tweet five, this or that.
Tweet five.
Should we crack another?
Tweet five.
Darling?
Five.
Would you mind? Do the honors? Or how about Rune? Rune, get on that. She's all strapped in, for fuck's sake.
<It's the problem. laughs>
That's why I love her. She's funny, too.
I'm killing him.
Yeah,
I'm killing Elaine. Elaine's out there. She's saying, I look like a fool in front of Billy's guests because you keep making me laugh in the chat room, and then I'm laughing to myself.
Aw, that's all right. You guys are having
fun. Now she's complaining about me. Can you hear?
Yeah. She didn't say those things.
She's got hair out there.
But you are in a pit of snakes.
Yes, exactly. So. Stop kidding yourself. All right. Tweet 5, this or that. Here we go. Strap in. Frank Zappa or Captain Beefheart?
Fuck.
I know. Again, with the music.
With the music, Frank Zappa.
Sinbad or Jay Leno? Boy, that's an odd one.
You know what? A spring almost popped out of my head.
I saw it get unhinged.
I'll say Jay Leno because I don't have to be on Sinbad's show.
Yeah, that's pretty smart there, Billy. You know, you made the right selection there. Movies or theater?
Movies.
Cardinals or Royals? Are you kidding
Cardinals.
Me? Are you not paying attention? Live or recorded, playing music yourself?
Live or recorded, playing music myself. I'm not sure what that means.
Of your own music, perhaps.
Oh, do I prefer my own music live or record? Oh, yeah, I see. I prefer recording. I love the recording studio very much.
As opposed to performing live in front of an audience?
Yeah, because live, you have the fans there who are there to see you and hear your music. And you have the ones who are there to say horrible shit to you and throw something at you. And
right.
Why did you look at my girlfriend? That kind of stuff.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. So, yeah, recording studio.
Yeah.
Captain Beefheart and Zappa.
That's a tough one.
That's really wild because Beefheart is he was an art, like a Dada artist of some type.
Yeah.
So musically, I don't know about that.
But they did shows together, perhaps why that's why the parallel was drawn.
Oh, no, absolutely. I get that. He was, Zappa and Beefheart, they grew up together.
I was very young when I saw Zappa sit on a stool and play the jazz guitar for 20 minutes solo in the middle of his show and pretty much changed my perspective on things.
Yeah, there's no comparison between Zappa and Beefheart as a musician.
In any way, shape, or form.
I mean, Zappa was a musician and Beefheart was an oddity of, he was a very strange guy, but still someone who inspired me because it's like, well, if he can be that fucking guy. I used to talk to Beefheart on the phone.
Is that right?
And he wouldn't see people, he had MS or he wouldn't see people over the years, but I would talk to him on the phone for hours sometimes. And I just loved the way he would put things sometimes. And one time I said, so Don, he lived up around Trinidad, California. He told me he lived on this hill and you could see the ocean there and there were these sheep out there. And I said, I was talking to him one night, I said, so Don, you said you could see the ocean from your house, right? And he goes, yes, and it can see me too.
Oh, wow. That's nice.
That was great.
Yeah.
To have Beefheart say one of those things. And he signed a couple of his art books to me, which are some of my prized possessions. But Zappa was the reason I left home.
Yeah, really?
It was the reason I left Arkansas.
What was it in his music that spoke to you to that level? Just a calling?
I was in a small town in the South and, got, like our movies were whatever was at the one theater we had. So we didn't get
first run
the Jim Jarmusch movie or whatever, of the time.
Certainly.
We got Dick Van Dyke in Lieutenant Robin Crusoe. You know what I mean? That kind of thing.
Nice pull.
Yeah, whatever the Disney movie was at the time. And so my brother and I, who were both in bands when we were little kids, he and I would go to the record store, and that was our mecca. I mean, it was just the holy grail was to find that record that was a gem to you, and we would thumb through them all day long. And I just... remember seeing a Mother's cover and going, wow, what is that?
What the hell's this?
I gotta figure this out. And just, I started listening to Freak Out and We're Only in It for the Money and all that stuff when I was, 11 years old. And it showed me a whole different, first of all, the sense of humor.
Yeah.
Which we didn't have. It's funny, you know, I have friends who I respect as actors or musicians or whatever. I respect what they do, and I don't know how they do it because they're not smart enough.
Wow. Yeah, yeah,
does that
yeah.
make any sense?
It's, of course it does.
It's because the sense of humor is so
intelligent.
Standard with their sense of humor.
Oh, I'm saying, right.
It's so pedestrian and whatever that it's like, how do you play a guitar like in some this magical spiritual fucking shit that nobody and then you talk to the guy and he's like
yeah
and you know and his idea of a joke is his dog bites you, you know, and he thinks it's funny as shit, you know,
but he can change your religion with a lick. Yeah.
And it's like, how does that happen? Well, Zappa was the guy for me that, see, my brother and I had that sense of humor.
Right.
And I couldn't talk to anybody but my brother, you know, who died in 1988, God rest his soul. And so he and I would buy these records and listen to them, and like anybody in our school would listen to it and go, what kind of crap is that?
Mm.
And that's what made me think, I better get out of here.
Yeah, really.
You know, I better find some other place because, you know, people like me here, but I don't think they know why.
Right. Oh, interesting.
You know, and that's why people will come up to me about Sling Blade and say, man, Sling Blade is fantastic. I love that movie. It's funnier than shit.
Oh, my God.
And then I'm thinking, glad you like it, but it really ain't funnier than shit, because if you think about what it's about.
It's a tragedy.
It has a very, very, very heavy religious message, or anti-religious message, or whatever you want to call it.
Oh, we all knew what you meant.
Yeah. You know? And it has, and it's like, did you get the part about the gay guy is a better father to the kid than the guy that is a Bible thumper, or you know, or whatever? I mean, did you get that part?
Yeah.
You know, so to say it's funnier than shit, while I appreciate you buying the ticket,
yeah,
and you know, and liking the movie, you didn't really like it for the reasons it was written.
Not for its intention, no.
Yeah.
Thanks for laughing at the man in pain.
Exactly. So I think that's, you know, Frank Zappa was really the catalyst, and I talked to Jim Jarmusch about that one time, who's from Akron, Ohio, and it was funny because. Which was another tough one when you asked the Coen brothers and Jim Jarmusch.
Yeah.
I only said the Coen brothers because Jim doesn't call me as often as they do. But
it's really a business play so
exactly,
far.
Exactly, exactly. Call me up, Jim. You know?
So far, we got you booked on Leno, and the Coen exactly. brothers are waiting outside.
But one way or the other, you know, Jim said that Zappa was the reason he left Akron, Ohio. And he said that kind of changed his life in a way. You know, it made him know that he wasn't the only guy who was considered to be in this avant-garde world or whatever, you know.
Right.
Where you could actually be a commercial artist to a degree. And still do your thing, you know.
Right.
And that's what that was about.
Yeah. Well, it's to a brush with a true original who could put butts in the seats and be misunderstood by the masses for the most part, but still sell them records was a pretty bizarre hat trick, to say the least.
And didn't sell records, you know, like the big artist did.
Didn't have to. Yeah.
And I think I told you earlier, my little girl, Bella, as we speak, is at Moon Zappa's daughter Matilda's birthday party. And,
right.
The fact that I hang out with Gail and Moon and Diva and all of them these days is just, I can't believe it. I mean, that was the guy that made me come out here.
Right. So. Yeah. I really meant it. When I was quite young. In fact, I remember, I was just thinking as you were saying that the guy, I must have been in someplace in high school, and the fellow student, I will say, who I thought was just kind of a tough kid from a broken home, shocked the hell out of me when he turned me on to Frank Zappa. Mm. And I wasn't, as soon as I was able to wrap my brain around what the greatness was that Zappa was offering, I immediately was looking at this guy in a whole different light, who had turned me on to it. That was the sort of power from that music for me, that I never forgot, was it could change your perspective of people who enjoyed it and who got it and who cared about it and wanted to share it. And then when I saw him live, and like I said, I'd never seen, I'd never been to a concert ever where the main attraction sat down on a stool and did a solo for 20 minutes. That was a little bit unheard of. Sure. And I, coming from San Francisco, of course, I had, without realizing it, the great Bill Graham, one of the great concert promoters of the 20th century, who brought every great act in the world through the San Francisco Bay Area. And I had my share and my fill of some pretty amazing live acts. But but that 20-minute period of him sitting on that stool playing was something that just, it does. It resonates and changes your perspective of of why you thought you liked music.
Yeah.
Or in your case, why people thought they liked you.
Well, and exactly, because it wasn't only music.
Nope.
It was theater.
Yeah. And the sense of humor, as you said, was mind-blowing.
Yeah, it was. Yeah. And also, you know, it was subversive. It was
wildly,
political.
Wildly subversive. But and then there was this catchy side to it where you could sing along and actually kind of perform the songs yourself as if it were the Dave Clark Five.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yes, the Dave Clark Five. Was he a stand-up drummer, or did I make that up?
He sat on a very high stool.
Was that what it was?
He sat on a very high stool.
I figured you'd know this as a drummer.
And from what I hear, still sits on a very high stool.
But is the caller there?
But he didn't come to our show in London. But he played Rogers, Red Sparkle Rogers kit. I'll never forget it. I was obsessed with everything about the British Invasion. Mm-hmm. And we loved the Dave Clark Five.
Me and my guys.
We played all their tunes. You know, everybody else was being the Beatles or the Stones, and we thought, well, we'll be different. We'll be the Dave Clark Five in my band when I was like 10 or 11. You know? Mm-hmm. And yeah, we played all that stuff, Glad All Over and Because, all those songs. But Dave Clark had his stool up really high, so he appeared to be kind of just squatting in a way, you know.
Barely sitting.
Barely,
almost standing.
Barely sitting, exactly. And he also was known for, if you ever look back at the Ed Sullivan performances or any of this stuff, he didn't use cymbals much.
Whoa.
A drummer who did, you know, rarely used his cymbals. He would play like the beat on the floor tom and the, you know, dum 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 dum, you know, all this kind of stuff, and rarely crash his cymbals or use the hi-hat. You know. As opposed to Ringo, who did that a lot. You
right.
know, and those were the drummers we loved. I mean, Levon Helm is another one with the band.
Yeah.
Levon and Dave Clark and Ringo and Charlie Watts, you know, we weren't guys who grew up with guys like Neil Peart or Terry Bozzio, guys who have like seem to have like eight arms like an octopus or something, who can do a million things. And you know, we just always thought, you know, you keep the beat, you know, don't fuck with the, you know, band, and just, you know, do your job. And
your job was to not mess up the song.
Exactly. And you know, make sure it's got a foundation, and you know, when the singer gets excited, you can get a little more excited too.
Right. I remember talking to a drummer once. I would open up for bands on the auspices of Bill Graham, so I got to know a few. The drummer would often say, you know, one of my jobs is to really keep an eye out on the audience and try to single out some girls that we might talk to after the show.
Exactly. That was a drummer thing.
And also, it was a Bill Graham show, sorry to keep going, prattling on, he was one of my heroes, where I saw The Who live, and Keith Moon was the only drummer that I ever saw put on his own show. He seemed to be utterly oblivious to the bandmates or the song. Or what he was literally looking out to the audience while he was playing as if there it was the theater. Oh, yeah. My, was it theater?
Yes, it was.
Oh, man.
He was amazing, Keith Moon. To be able to do that much, which is way over playing, and still make a sound for a band that's, you know, that Well, it's one of the things that to this day, you know, we can hear a Who song, and it's just that thing.
Yep.
It's just the Who, you know, and he was a part of that sound. Most drummers who did that wouldn't work out that way, I don't think, you know, because it's usually intrusive.
Right.
But with him, it made sense, and
you're
I guess, you know, with him, with Pete, you know, banging his guitar like he did, you know, I think it worked out with those guys too. They were the original punk band, I think, the Who.
That's an interesting way to put it, but it certainly makes sense. I would just. You're absolutely right. There's no reason for that drummer to work with that band or any other.
Yeah.
It'd just be a solo artist out on stage by himself.
Exactly.
And you don't think about it being anything different than the song that he's in with them.
Yeah.
There was a question. It came up about the Coen brothers. We've had some amazing people at this table. I don't know that we've had someone who's worked with the Coen brothers. Oh, no, I take that back. But we talked about a lot of times about the difficulty of being a true original and about answering to your own beat and rhythm. The ability to reach a point as a filmmaker where your movies are only compared to your other movies. My first experience with that coming up as a fan of film would be actually Woody Allen, because I leaned more towards comedy as a kid, where every movie these guys make doesn't get compared to the films that are out at that time, doesn't get compared to any other filmmaker but their own. It's such a bizarre aspect of a career. And I wonder, when working with someone like the Coen brothers, where you know, it isn't, a lot of times, tell me your experience in terms of research or just becoming familiar with material for the job at hand. Whether you're ever in a position of stepping outside of it and thinking in terms of, well, these guys, I'm being asked to play for the Cardinals here. There's a very specific rhythm and history to this team. And I have a responsibility that goes beyond the drinkers of the Anheuser-Busch magic, liquid magic. You know what I mean? There is a certain, it goes beyond stamp. It goes beyond just about any word I can think of other than a responsibility to the artist. Is there any sense of that for you? Was there a sense of that?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
100%. I've been, among the circles I've worked in, I've been known as an improvisational actor a lot of times, or someone who brings well, I generally do different looking guys and, you know, different types of characters and things like that. And that's something that I count on. I mean, when I get there, I'm hoping, you know, like you read the script, it's, yeah, this is good. I think I'm the guy for this, you know, and then, or I'm not the guy for this. But within that framework, you always go in there thinking, oh, I know, you know, I have an idea how I might do this or how I might go off of this a little bit. With the Coen brothers, I never dared, when we made The Man Who Wasn't There, which was the first movie I did with them. I've been associated with three movies of theirs. They were executive producers on Bad Santa, but you know, they weren't really that involved in that one. But I also did a movie with them that I can never remember the title of. Because it sounds like some other movie I did one time or something that was, and I started to say The Unbearable Lightness of Being, but I know that wasn't it. Intolerable Cruelty.
There you go.
But I also had a scene in the one with Robert Redford where they give him the money to sleep with Demi Moore.
Oh, right.
I was in one scene. I was in two scenes. One was cut, but I was in that movie also, and I mix them up.
I didn't know that they had that was their movie.
No. I'm just saying that the movie that I'm mixing up with.
Oh, I see the title. Right. Indecent Proposal.
Indecent Proposal. Intolerable Cruelty.
Cruelty. You're right. That is too similar.
Yes.
In an annoying way to a couple of others.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So, the first one was Man Who Wasn't There, and I had to carry a movie, be the lead actor.
Boy, did you.
In a movie where I barely talked.
Yeah.
That was the trick. So I'm thinking, well, you know, I certainly won't be ad-libbing much in this, will I? but I'm narrating the whole film. So I did have a lot of dialogue, as it turns out. The Coen brothers, I think, initially thought that character was going to be a little more animated than I was. That's all I brought to that part, other than what they'd written. So when you go in there with them, their scripts are written so tightly, and if you don't do this here on page 20, it's going to affect what's happening on page 42. So you don't go in there and start saying, hey, you know, I thought I might do a little razzmatazz here and there, or just plain old do it. The camera moves are even so specific that you have to, in other words, if I'm sitting here and I'm saying this line, this guy is supposed to look up at you, they may be coming in on the dolly right here and it's going to end right on your last word. I mean, they do things like that.
Mm-hmm.
It's really master filmmaking.
Yeah, it is.
So I've got to do that thing. So you keep it in mind all the time. I had one change in the script of The Man Who Wasn't There. There's a scene where Scarlett Johansson is trying to give me a blowjob in this car. And we have a car.
I was hoping you would talk about this scene.
And she's going to go down on me and all this kind of stuff, and then we have this wreck, right? Well, the night before I shot that scene, I was watching, Angie and I used to watch one of my favorites, Snagglepuss.
Is that right? One of your favorites?
One of my favorites. And she had gotten me a collection of Snagglepuss cartoons from Hanna-Barbera or whoever the hell it was.
A regular pussycat.
Exactly.
All right already.
That guy. One of the things he used to say was, heavens to Murgatroyd.
Absolutely.
And he would also say, heavens to Betsy sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
And I love, and because Ed Crane, the guy I played in Man Who Wasn't There, was in the 40s, and he had that kind of language, you know. That's the way he spoke. And I was watching the Snagglepuss cartoon with Angie. I said, you know what? I'm going to ask Joel and Ethan tomorrow if I can say heavens to Betsy, because I love that thing. And because Ed Crane, if he were really amped up and were going to curse, he might say heavens to Betsy. So I went in the next day and I went up to Ethan and I said, Ethan, listen, I was wondering if I could change a lot or add a line to this scene. And Ethan, who's very funny and very, very sarcastic, Ethan goes, yeah, sure, Billy.
What an invitation.
Yeah.
My word.
Yeah, all right. Yeah, say your little line. You know, like it's ever going to be in there.
Sure, whatever you need for us to cut out later.
And Joel comes up, and Joel goes, so Ethan tells me you want to say a line.
Wow, they really do work together, don't they?
Yeah. And he goes, and Joel goes, what is it? You know, and I go, I want to say heavens to Betsy Birdie, because Birdie was Scarlett's character. And when she's going down on me, I want to say heavens to Betsy Birdie. And Joel goes, and they're very funny guys. They tilt their head a lot and kind of whine, you know. And Joel's like, that sounds all right, you know. And Ethan goes, I guess that's all right, you know. So I do the line, you know. She goes down, and I go, heavens to Betsy Birdie, and then we have the wreck and everything. And it actually became a cool thing. They loved it, and people even come up and say it sometimes to me. You know, it's one of those things.
Heaven to Betsy Birdie.
Heavens to Betsy Birdie. But, you really stick to their script. When I did Intolerable Cruelty, I played this soap opera actor who was posing as a Texas oil millionaire or something like that. And in that one, they actually said, you know, you can kind of go off on some of this shit and do your own thing. So I had a scene in there where I actually ad-libbed a little bit.
Well, after the Heavens to Betsy Birdie experience.
They'd let me do whatever the fuck
I wanted. They pretty much wanted to lean on you.
Exactly.
For entire scenes.
Exactly.
But have you got anything more like that, kid?
Yeah. What's the Heavens to Betsy of this film?
Could you bring it home for us?
But they're very, very accommodating. But, you know, the thing is you don't want to do anything else. I mean, they've written a brilliant script when you show up, so yeah. You don't want to do anything to it.
Right.
You know.
I mentioned Barry Levinson passing earlier, but he's quite
he
a
died?
Character. No. In passing.
Oh. But you said, you mentioned Barry
sorry.
Levinson's passing. I'm like, fuck.
No, in passing. I found him to be unbelievably funny.
Yeah.
And just sitting around chewing the fat on the set, I was shocked how funny he was.
One of the funniest guys I ever met in my entire lifetime. If I could pick one director solely for the experience of making the movie with him, being there with him for 3 or 4 months. When we did Bandits, you know, Bruce Willis, one of my best friends in the world, this guy, Bruce Willis is another fun guy to hang out with, but in a different way from Barry.
Yes, sir,
and,
considerably.
And Bruce, when he comes to a set, I've done, you know, 3 or 4 movies with Bruce, and when he gets there, he's usually all business and, you know, and he can be very intense, you know, with people on the set. And he maintains his Bruce Willisness, you know. I saw Bruce Willis turn into a giggling, dumbass 12-year-old.
Yeah.
Around Barry Levinson.
Yeah.
Bruce just cracked. He couldn't help it. I mean, Barry would go into one of his stories, and we're supposed to be shooting a scene. And Kate Blanchett and Bruce and I would just be standing around Barry at the monitor, you know, just captivated.
I think he does movies just so he can cast actors that he admires just to see if he can make them laugh.
Probably so.
Because he spends so much time doing just that.
Never seen anything like it.
I've never seen him direct a scene. I did a movie with him. He didn't direct a single scene.
Right.
Okay, Billy, you're there, and Corey, you're behind the monitor there, and I'm just going to, Rune, you're happy with your hands in your pockets.
That's fantastic.
Cut. Outstanding. what's the other word? Not outstanding. It's he had one word that he used over and over and over.
I remember outstanding.
Yeah, there was another one similar to it. It'll come to me. But then he would come over and say, "All right, so you have the cigarettes and the glass and the cup, and there's the you got the headset on there, Rune, and never told anyone to change anything. Never gave an actual direction."
You know what he used to do to me? I've never said this publicly. He would come up to me, and we're on this movie for 4 months at all kind of locations, having the best time, the best movie-making experience I ever had was making Bandits, in terms of just the, you know, the pure experience,
fun.
The fun,
yeah.
Every day on the set. And Bruce and I would just look at each other thinking, are we in heaven or what? Gorgeous, amazing locations. We're with the greatest, most beautiful actress alive, Kate Blanchett here, just
right
here with us every day. And a director who's like fucking, you know, a comedian. I mean, a guy who's entertaining us every day, like he's Bob Hope entertaining the troops.
Literally.
And everything was just perfect. The one thing that happened every day on the set, which I might have even told you this, Barry didn't understand that I never do what I'm going to do until we're actually doing it.
Mm.
And we would rehearse. And Barry would, every fucking time, come up and act the scene out for me. And he would say, Well, no, when you give him the money, you got to, I wish I could do him like you because I could do it exactly, you know, it would be perfect. But you'd say, well, you know, you're behind the thing and the customer comes in and the cop and you give him the thing and you got to be a little more intense with him and look up at him and do, and you, it's like, and then da-da-da and da-da, and he would do this act, right? And I'd go, okay, I will. And we'd rehearse it again and you'd come over again and you'd go, yeah, but when you do the thing, when we do the take, Barry, I will. I'll do that. Yeah. And then we'd do the take, and he would, you know, like you said, he would say, outstanding.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
And I never got it through to him that that's kind of the way I do things.
Until the camera's rolling.
Until the camera's rolling, I don't do any of this. What I do is I go, okay, I take the money, I put the thing down over here, I light the smoke, I tell him to fuck off, and then that's how I rehearse, because I don't like to rehearse, you know. And
it sounds like you might like myself, but around take three, you just hear yourself acting.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I mean, for me, the first take, I mean, one thing people don't really know about actors is that, and a lot of directors don't know this about actors, is actors don't get better. They only get worse. You know, it's not
like. Or they get different.
Or they get
But they don't get better.
But they don't get better.
Yeah.
I mean, on take 60, at this point, you're fucking, you know, you think you're John Gielgud and shit, you know, or either that or you want to go home and tell the director to fuck himself or something, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
But usually take one or two if there's no camera problem, you know, that's probably the most natural thing you're going to get. You know?
And as a director, is that your MO?
Absolutely. As a matter of fact, a lot of times when I hire a local actor for something, I usually don't tell them the camera's on. I usually tell them that the camera crew is full of shit and they're busting my balls here. We're running out of time and these idiots got to get some more marks. So just run through the scene. If you forget it, if you mess up the lines, don't worry about it. You know, I'm not worried about that. This is for these idiots. You know, I just gave away the secret. And now I'm going to hire locals. They're going to be...
We don't,
you
don't,
I saw you on that Bill Maher show or whatever it is. I know your trick.
Yeah, you know, don't play, don't call them idiots. I know what you want me to do.
You
this.
Know the one with a hat. You know
that fella that's always wearing a hat. Yeah. Man. Well, I did want to talk just a little bit, and then I'll drive you home, as Paul Reiser used to say. Let me just say this, and then I'll drive you home. Sam Raimi is also one of those very unique characters who usually, if not always, wears a suit to work with a tie, and couldn't be more proper, almost out of some sort of the tip of the hat to a time gone by when the director would dress that way to work. Mm-hmm. But there's a sense of a gentle soul.
Yeah.
Did you ever have an opportunity to see that crack?
Never.
Yeah. I don't know.
Sam is like he's like one of the kids out of a 50s TV show or something. It never changes, and he's a sweet human being.
Hey,
buddy, how's everybody today, buddy? You know, he's just the nicest guy on earth. And then you see, like, all those Evil Dead things he does. And, by the way, the guy who wrote A Simple Plan, you know, Sam's directing the movie.
Right.
And Scott Smith wrote the novel and wrote the screenplay for the movie. Scott Smith looks like Howdy Doody.
Really?
Scott Smith is like, you know, Ron Howard. He's like Opie, you know. And so you got these two sort of 1950s milk drinking guys making these fucking
sick twisted
fucking edgy movies and things, you know. It's I guess it's all that repression or something. I don't know what it is, but you know, and guys like me, I'm always looking, begging people to let me play a dad in a Disney movie so my kids will, you know, be able to grow up and actually watch one of my movies or something, you know.
And
there I am out there doing what I do. But I mean, you guys like Sam Raimi, you just don't understand.
But it's pure and it's real and it's not an act and it's
not
just who the guy is, and
yeah,
he couldn't be more peculiar and lovable.
Nicest guy in the world. You know, my favorite gift I've gotten lately, last year for Christmas, I got the Fruit of the Month Club from Sam Raimi and his wife.
Really?
And It's like the best fruit on earth. It's like, what was that Albert Brooks movie where you go to partway through to heaven, you know, and you...
Defending your life.
Defending your life. And like the food they're yes. waiting to, you know, figure yeah. out what's happening.
You like shrimp, buddy?
Right. And the guy eats an omelet and it makes him have an orgasm.
Oh my God, this is the greatest yeah, omelet exactly. I've ever had in my life. Yet.
Exactly.
Yeah. That's this, the fruit that Sam
fruit
Raimi...
Of the month, this Fruit of the Month Club shit is like, I ate a pear. It was like butter. I can't believe this fucking pear.
Because, so
I, you know, and Sam Raimi sent me Fruit of the Month Club. Somehow, it's like he's the... What was the little angel in Wonderful Life?
Clarence.
Clarence.
Yeah.
It's like Clarence sent me some fruit that's fucking heavenly or something, you know? And that's who Sam Raimi is.
You know, right? What's missing from that is Sheldon Leonard playing Nick the bartender. Oh, yeah, oh right. Absolutely. That was one of the very first impressions I ever did. And people said, why would you do Nick the bartender? Who's going to pay to do Sheldon Leonard? All right, that's it. You two pixies, out the door or out the window. Oh, that's all right, Nick. He's with me. And that's another thing. Where do you come off calling me Nick? All right. I'm done showing off.
God, I wish I could do impressions.
I can't thank you enough, honest to goodness, for giving us a couple hours of your time, especially during the holiday crunch when you got your daughter just sitting by the tree waiting for Santa to come. This movie that you're gearing up to, this is, you haven't directed in a while. You purposely, according to your dossier,
yeah.
from the Pretty Horses thing with the studio, kind of turned off some juices there.
Yeah.
They fucked with the wrong Marine, in a sense.
Yeah.
And but I'm thrilled to death you're coming back to it, honestly.
Well, I'm really happy about it. I'm really anxious.
Is this something you wrote?
Yeah, I wrote this script with my old writing partner, Tom Epperson.
Who you started writing with when you first came out here for One False Move. And
he and I wrote The Gift together and One False Move and a movie called A Family Thing with Robert Duvall and James Earl Jones. And this movie is... It's one of those things, you write it and it's like everything you think about every day and you can't wait to do it.
Mm.
And it's just kind of like the stuff I've always done. I think it's funny and I think it's got some magic to it. And we're still trying to get it financed. We hope we're going to do it in the spring. And, you know, a lot of people, everybody in the world wants to finance this movie and they want to finance it for half of what we need.
Right.
And we need very little.
I'm sure.
But the times are different. If I walk in today to the studio and say, I'd like to direct another movie, it's about teenage vampires, it's in 3D, all the vampires are Calvin Klein models, only the funny guy is Seth Rogen, I'd get the movie made just like that. But unfortunately, you know, and it used to be the movie business would disguise their evilness.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? They don't even do that anymore.
Nope.
'Cause they know they don't have to.
No.
They used to be like cobras in mink stoles, you know.
Well, interesting and yet 100% true.
Now they're just cobras.
Yeah.
They just threw the mink stole away and said, fuck you. Yeah, we're in control and we're gonna tell you exactly how it is. So you walk in and you go, here's the script. I'd love for you to just give us a meager amount of money to do this.
And here's all the actors that have said yes.
Yeah, we have some actors who have said yes who are world class.
Yeah, they are.
Eight of them. And they read the script and they go, yeah, it's an amazing cast, it's an amazing script. We'll give you $50 to do it. And I'm like, but we can't make it for $50. We need $100, you know? And they say, yeah, but it's one of those kind of movies. If it's a different kind of movie, it's a different story. But it's that kind of movie. And I go, what kind of movie? Well, you know, for adults, and it's...
There's no way to get a 14-year-old to sit through this.
Yeah, exactly. It has no, you know, shit, you know, that somebody made on a computer last night, and, you know, whatever. So we can't do it. It doesn't resemble a video game in any sense. So we can't give you the money to do it. We'll give you the money, but not that kind of money, you know. And so that's what we're going through right
Marketing
now.
Marketing says we'll give you half of what you need.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And so we're still trying to get it financed, and we're very close with people, and we're close to getting it financed with people outside this country mainly, and not, for the most part, even in the movie business. And we're close to some people in Texas who aren't in the movie business who just say things like, $12 million, fuck, I spend that on valets.
Those are the people you want writing the check.
And I burped
that up this morning.
Exactly. And so you say, you know, look, we'd love to do this movie. And they go, look, we might like to come hang out with you and get in the movie business. So hopefully some of those guys are going to do it. And God bless them. I mean, that's the only angels we have right now.
Yeah.
And so it's better for people who want to make good movies for adults. And the movies that we're known for making, you know, guys like us, and hopefully you're going to get that one made because that's a terrific script. And,
thank you. Yeah, we're out to our third actress now. We're going to one by one get denied by all the greats. So far, we're 2 for 2, but we're going after greats, which is what we need for the hitter. So
absolutely.
Yeah. Thank you.
Ruth Buzzi, have you gone to her yet?
We end on a high note.
That's right.
I've realized what a horrible error I've made. Ruth Buzzi is the answer to all my dreams.
I always had a crush on Ruth Buzzi for some reason.
Even when she dressed up like the old bag woman.
Yes.
She couldn't have been more sexy.
Something about her.
Yeah. You're right. Yeah. Oh, man. Thank you so much. Go Cards.
Yeah.
The band might be back on tour in the summer.
Yeah.
We've put up a few times on the screen there the website for the band where people can go to and check out all the catalog, mm-hmm. the library. As
actually,
it
was just the name of the band, but the website is thebandsname.com.
Yeah.
Boxmasters?
Yes. Boxmasters.com.
Boxmasters.com.
That's all it is. There it is now. So please go there. Maybe in time for Christmas if you get off your ass, folks. That might be something there for you.
We got a Christmas record. It's pretty funny.
You son of a bitch. That's the way I like to think of Christmas. Honestly and truly, and it meant a great deal to us, me specifically, that you could come down and spend time here.
Well, I'm happy to be here. It's always great to do a real show, you know.
A real conversation. Yeah. And share a couple stories.
Yeah.
Appreciate it.
Cool.
Sit there uncomfortably for about 90 seconds while I wrap this thing up.
You got it.
And we'll get on out of here. All right, a very happy holidays to you and yours, and happy new year. We'll see you in the new year. Our first guest on January 9th is Stephen Root, as mentioned. He will perhaps share a little about the leaning, whining Coen brothers as well, which is how they should be remembered, those brilliant bastards who love to lean and whine. I couldn't be a bigger fan, God damn it. Let's make that clear. Anyways, as I said before, check the calendar, see who's coming up. I do wish you and yours a very, very happy holiday and happy new year, and I hope it's a great one for all of us. Until then, and as always, and thank everyone who came in here during the Halloween
week.
Is there a crew gag? Is there a crew gag? Now, when you say crew gag, you're already suggesting that the crew has worked on something. But instead, let's say for the last 2 hours and 10 minutes while we've been having this lovely chat, I wonder, just outside these walls, what the rest of my crew has been up to. J-Mac, the Wile E. Coyote of the group, has been given a gift by Josh Nagler.
Well,
look at that.
Dancer,
thank you so much, he says. He rips in the carefully wrapped gift. Seems to be going at it from a very specific angle. He's confused. Oh, I see. It's another gift. Right. I better open this one from a very specific angle as well. Because I don't want to disrupt. Sure as shit. It's, you guessed it, another wrapped gift. Thanks, buddy. He says to Josh, who can't wait to figure out what his cut is. Oh, look. J-Mac's had enough now. It's not funny anymore. He's, oh, nice! Nice! And we finally see what's been in him all this time. It took 94 shows for J-Mac to lose his shit. It's the pile driver! The pile driver! Wait! He's got a nutcracker. Sweet! Oh! A bloodshot! That, my friends, is what the holiday spirit is all about. Thanks for the extra effort from outside these hallowed walls. Thanks for Jamie for reminding this old man that there is a thing called the crew gag that comes at the end of the show. And Larry King game. Oh, no. We'll slide on the Larry King game. I've wrapped up. We're past that point. We've driven past it.
I was just making sure that you weren't being old and senile.
Both. God bless us all, everyone.
That's why we need Emily.
I know,
to make
right?
lists and check them off.
Ah, damn. More of this in the new year. Here's hoping. As always, and to you and yours, get out of my face.
He's all of the rainbows, but none of the rain. He's dry. He's scared.